Sun Studios, brought to you by Old Mutual.
And very many welcome to AMPD MasterClass by Old Mutual. My name is MacG, and we're coming at you live from AMPD Studios in Newtown Junction Mall. Also joined by the legend, Kwesta himself. So the reason why we had to have you here, because I think it's very important to learn about financial health, financial responsibility, especially as we head into the festive season. I think whether you're an upcoming artist or a well-established artist like yourself, it's important to handle your money wisely.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we've gone through something we've never seen before, that is COVID and stuff, where a lot of incomes were cut. Not reduced or anything, cut. So what started counting the most is what you've been doing with the money you've been getting before this, you know. And personally, that's how I've been surviving with whatever I've been putting on the side. So I'm happy I was a little bit, you know, savvy with it.
Tell us about your come up. How did you get into the industry? You know, what are some of the things that you've learned?
I came up the old way, man. I came up from recording with like an earpiece microphone, like a call center type thing. And I could only record a minute of everything I was recording, you know, so that's how I started off. But, you know, when your skill gets better and better, you meet people, different types of people, and I eventually got into a place where I could record properly, and I cut a demo, you know. I asked my moms for a choco, Bambi cab, it ended up being entertainment, you know, where Slicker and Sugar Smacks were. I got there, I tried to play them my demo, and before I even pressed play, they said, "Nah, we're not looking to sign anyone, you know, right now." But ngayishi it demo, you know, and I left. Obviously, Nhliziyo ibuhlungu at that time. I'm like, damn, I really wanted to. There goes the dream, right? But 2 days later, they made the mistake of listening to it. they made the big mistake of listening to it, and I got the call, and it's been a hell of a ride since. Yeah.
So what was your assumptions about the game?
I thought right after the call from Slick that I'm rich, I'm famous, you know, I'm well known. I thought my dreams had come true, you know. But what I learned was that was just an opportunity for me to work, you know, to kind of show how hard I can work, you know. So all my sort of intervening is kabanga game with time. As soon as bavulumnyango, that means that's when you start working. If anything, you work harder than you did before you got your shot, you know. And that's a misconception a lot of people have. They think once the door is open, everything's fine. Once the door is open, you kind of have to give reason of why the door was open for you. So you kind of have to work harder than you did before the door was open. So my assumptions were that everything was going to be fine, but everything took a lot of work, you know. I mean, it took like, I signed with Slick and Smacks in like 2007. You know, and we did a lot of groundwork in building the name, but it really only popped off in like 2012. You know, it was really when it, and if you think about it, that's like a 5-year thing after being signed. You understand me? So I realized that it really is just an opportunity for you to work harder. And what's great about it though is that if you love it, it's never really work, you know. But yeah, that's what I thought the game was. I thought it was all glitz, glamour, this, that, and the third, everything I saw on TV. And yeah, I was on TV, but that didn't mean I was bringing something home. I had to work for that, you know. I had to work for the name to come up the ranks, you know, to a position where we are now.
So you sign, you're thinking you got the money's not coming.
And when the money came, let me tell you, right after I signed, we did this hip hoop tour. It was like basketball and hip hop kind of thing where it was like a stage on a bus, you know, and I was, so immediately I'm going around the country, right? And I remember we went to like all the provinces, right? And some twice. So I think we went to like, we did like 15 shows, you know, just in a month or two, you know, and that was a great start. And the check for that was 12K. You know, I got 12,000 for 2 months' work. I was happy, and I was doing what I wanted. And immediately when I got that, Landa Machita, and we all went to Durban. And in about a week, I had no money. and I couldn't come back. So I was stuck in Durban for quite a while. Manje, Slick and Smacks have shows lined up and things like that. I'm not making those shows because I'm in Durban. You know what I mean? So, you know, but then, I mean, you come in and you learn. I thought that's just, it was an interesting time for me. I was like, because when I had that 12K, I'm rich. You know, I thought I was rich. I'd never had this money before. I mean, I'm 18 in Tuan. I've never made it for myself, any sort of money. And the first money is 12K. Of course I'm going to Durban, you know, and blowing it in about 3 days and then, you know, getting stuck. You know, but it's just, it is what it is.
So when stuff like that happens, what keeps you going? Because like you said, I mean, between 2007 and 2012, that's a long time to keep doing something.
Yeah.
And it's not yielding results. What made you be resilient and keep on pushing?
I think the fact that it didn't happen that quickly is what kept, there was always something to do. You know, there's always, so I'm like from 2007 till 2012, there's nothing. That means there's 2008, I got to do better than 2007. 2009, I got to do better than 2008. So there was always something to beat. And there was always something I hadn't done. And that's really what kept me going. And as you go, you kind of fall in love with the process, you know. So even after it popped off, it never really stopped because now I was just in love with the process of how things work, of how to build a brand. You learn that and how to build a song and how to, you know, sort of get to where you were going. And now I started falling in love with that process. And that's why I still do it, because even when I got to where I wanted to go in that time, and whenever you get somewhere, I always think there's like, new dreams, you know. I mean, if our guys will figure like new town as soon as we, you know, so funge senti, you know what I mean. So and the most senti, you know, funge Cape Town, you know, most, you know. So there's always something great about it, and that's what I love about the game. So that's what always kind of keeps me going. That there's things I haven't done, and I want to do them. So the unknown, I want to reach and feel what it's like to be here, and then feel what it's like to be there, and you know. So like the search for the unknown is really what I appreciate.
And what would you say is better for an upcoming artist? To get like a manual, a rule book of how it works? For example, you could be watching this masterclass now, yeah, and you've got kind of like a cheat code of how the industry works. Or would you rather advise someone to go through your journey where you have to learn on the go?
I know a lot of people that will sit in this chair and say, this is how you do it, right? I want to call bullshit on that. You know, I don't think there's a this is how you do it kind of manual. I mean, yes, I mean, if you're going to say, yo, you have to go performing, you have to make songs, that's the obvious part. You know, that's not the how, that's what you do. You know what I mean? So I feel like our stories and our come ups and maybe our destinies are different, which means no one man has gone through what you're gonna go through. Your destiny could be record your own stuff, put it on the net, and tomorrow you might be, you know, the biggest star we've ever seen. So I feel like you desire, it's all based on the type of things you want and on the type of sort of results you want something to garner, and you sort of custom make the process as you go. You custom make it, you see. You kind of try and calculate, because if you follow too much, you're following a path that won't have a destination that you're trying to go to. You know, wherever you go, you'll always kind of be behind someone because you were following them, you know. So I think you just pretty much tailor make everything as you go. You tailor make the process, you tailor make the people you're working around and how the environment of the people around you is, you know. Because everything is telling from the music. If the music is speaking about you, everything around you should also be a representative of that. So, and I don't think that can be duplicated in any way. So I don't want to hear anybody say, this is the only way to do this. You know, yes, that worked for you. Great, kudos, you know. But I'm not from where you're from. I don't have ichoko. Logutin bambi kep nyegu slik, you know. I don't, so the stories will never be the same. So then what it requires from you will also never be the same. And you might be making different type of music that never existed before. You know, you might create a new genre. And so who am I to say, here's how you sell this genre. Let me tell you what to do, because this is new and it's yours, you know. So you kind of have to tailor make it for everything.
Do you think it was harder to get in the game during your time, or do you think it's harder now?
I really think to get in the game now is much harder. And I'm not disrespecting what it took for me to get in the game or my generation, But there's so much content now. Every other day, there's a new joint. Every other day, there's a new artist. Every other day. And then also at the same time, the following day, that new artist is gone and unheard of again. That new artist is, you know, so it becomes so hard. There's an influx of so much good stuff and an influx of so much shitty stuff that there's just a bunch of stuff. So to stand out and to be a guy, people go, okay, but we're going to follow him, is much harder now. I mean, my problem was resource. You know, it was hard to find resource, but there was such a gap between me and the game, right? There was such a big gap based on resource and distance. I'm from Katlehong, and nobody was from there. You know what I mean? Like, there's no one moon. You know, I think probably the first celebrity I saw was Slick when I was asking for a deal. So resources made a big gap between me and the game. And I think now the struggles are different because technology has made it so much easier to record stuff and just put stuff out. And so the game is a lot closer. But there's so many people in there for you, no matter how close it is, to be noticed is much harder than it was then. I mean, I'm from the fact that I rapped alone kind of put me aside because nobody around me was rapping. It was easy to get attention because you were doing something nobody else was doing. Now, if you're doing something that everybody's doing, it's harder to get noticed in that clutter, you know. So I mean, it's different generations for different things. I don't want to say which one's better and which one's not, but I do feel like when now the big fight is how to get noticed more than how to, you know, put it out there for people to buy, put the music out there. That's easy, you know. It's the getting noticed that's tough.
As an OG, when you look at the game now, what do you think some of the mistakes that these up and coming artists are doing?
Identity, you know. A lot of the new guys sort of come in and want to do what's popping, you know, want to do what's hot. And there's not even genre-based or anything, just they don't tailor-make their stuff, you know what I mean? They really, so-and-so had a song like this and this, so I want to try get as close as possible to that type of song, you know, within. That means you're leaving yourself behind and you're not in the music, you know, because you're trying to sort of make a replica of a hit song, you know, you're trying to make a replica of a great looking video, you know, you're trying to do all these things that are not representative of you or your people or your beliefs or anything like that, you know. And I think that's a big one to fight because then what happened with hip hop is that as much as it's sort of like something that started in the States, you know, what happened with like people like HHP, Squatter Camp, Pro, you know, gave it like a South African identity, you know, even before that POC and them. And that's what got it interesting. That's what got the South African sort of go, okay, and maybe I could listen to this yo-yo stuff. Because the language, I swear, yo-yo, because manje ringa seya fana, you know, istrat ne rap was like one thing, you know, it didn't feel like I Liz, you know, and that's what identity was, because the South African authenticity was in the music, you know, the culture was in the music, is in the music, I guess. And I'm saying that what the new guys have to do is not the same thing, you know, but just represent what the South African sort of landscape and culture is about. Just identity, and don't make the same type of music, make your music. There's no way it's not going to be South African and have the South African culture because you're South African, you know. If you really just open yourself up to finding yourself in the music, it's going to be naturally South African because, you know, by default you are here, Hardy, but you are here.
I've heard you rap like when you were starting, you can easily do a Drake type song, but yet you decided to do Ngut.
Yeah.
Was the reasoning behind it, or it was just like, you know, this is what I want to do?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the time, Mangala, in the beginning, and I think all of us pretty much start off rap with like thumping a slung, or because, well, the first people I got exposed to was like Eminem and them, so the first rap I had wasn't what I heard was in English, so you start rapping in English because you copy and paste. And how I learned how to rap Velo was to learn other people's songs, and those songs were in English, so by default. And then when I started writing my own stuff, a lot of it was also in English, but a lot of it was also just pushed to prove the fact that I could rap. You know, it was always just, yo, I'm better than this, I'm better than you, and I just wanted everyone to know that I could rap. And I did that so much, as I felt like there's not a lot of me in this. There's just a lot of the fact that I'm better than you and I can rap and let me show. So it's a whole lot of showcase, but without substance, you know, who's this guy? You know, it was just a picture of things. There was no substance in that. And when I decided to just go, hey man, just be in the music, just kind of bring yourself to the music, bring that Katlehong guy to the music. Stop trying to tell us you can rap. We know, you know, you're amazing at it, but who are you, you know? And that's how songs like Ngu to come out, you know, because that's generally me on a daily. Look, she, I mean, it's just, I just describe that and put that out because that's me. And funny enough, that's how a lot of people then started listening and paying attention and kind of gravitating towards the music, because there's like a, oh yeah, that guy. So we're siding with that because we know what you're about. You know, we don't only know that you rap. I mean, we know the CV. Stop telling us about your CV. Now we know who you are and we've met you, and they can easily connect like that. So yeah, and it was a very conscious decision to go, I'ma just put my K1 flag everywhere and just be myself, you know. So and it made it easier for people to connect, because it almost felt like you were meeting me, you know. So it's like we became friends. Every time you bump the joint, like you go throw a party, you're not inviting me, because you got to play that joint, you know. So I was invited to every party, just even when I wasn't there, you know, because those songs were human, you know. Yeah.
All right, so now we've got the music on lockdown. Let's talk about music videos.
Yeah.
I know you're very passionate about that.
Yeah.
How important is it to have a music video in this current climate?
The visual aspect of this message that that music has is almost like an extension, not even almost. It's an extension of what's here and what is meant in the music. So the connection between the song and the music video is of utmost importance, according to me, because if I can also see it, you know, there's something about seeing something. It's one thing to know that 1 + 1 = 2, my palo chalk on the chalkboard, you know, but if it's 1 rand, you know, live, ganje, on a 2 rand, you know what I mean? So seeing something is an extension of the story of the music, and I feel like a lot of people want to shoot the music video to kind of sell the face. And well, that's what you get told, especially by record labels and stuff, is they shoot a music video so people can see your face, shoot a this, that, and that, so they know who you are, which is all good and dandy, you know. But really, I've seen sort of people do like inspirational song, you know, and go shoot that shit in the club with bottles, you know what I mean? So the relationship and the marriage of the music video and the music and what it gives to people, because I've always felt like we can sit here and talk a lot, but if you can see the things, you can see the passion behind what it took to make the music. If you can shoot a music video that captures that, this thing is not only just something they hear, it's something they see, it's something that starts living inside of them. So I've always just felt like, do not downplay the importance of a music video for the extension of the song and the extension of yourself, and also just to tell this story for whoever is watching. And that's what I think a music video represents and should represent. So the marriage between the music and a music video should be well paired and should be, you know, well taken care of.
And what part do you have to play in all your music videos? Because when I look at a track like Spirit,
yeah,
the track is dope.
Yeah.
Watch the video, it just elevates it and makes it even doper.
Yeah. The conceptualization of stuff, especially of that music video, was done by some amazing people, well, at least shots wise. You know, what I wanted was to capture the heart of the song and really speak about where we're from and really not be afraid to showcase what we do and what we're about, whether good or bad, you know. There's a scene where there's like a chicken sort of getting slaughtered and stuff, and they try to get us into trouble for that. I'm like, well, come to the hood, you'll see it in real life, and arrest everyone, yeah, or find everybody. I don't know what you're trying to do. I mean, if I'm supposed to showcase who we are as a people, I'm supposed to showcase what is controversial according to you, and I'm just supposed to tell you the truth about the music and about where I'm from. So I literally just said, I just want to capture the heart and essence of not only Katlehong, of Ilogish generally, and how we are, you know. And Nota, Nota got Tebuch Malope, who at first I'm like, yeah, okay, you know. And then when he shot that thing and he started speaking about what he's seeing and what he wants to do, I was like, bro, it's amazing. Let me tell you, that man shot that. He pitched it and spoke about it in such a way that he became one with it. Like I knew what he knew and he knew what I wanted, and he could say it before, like he knew it like the back of his hand, you know? So he shot that thing and he shot it, and then literally, normally, because you shoot a video and then try edit, you know, and then it goes back, I second edit, I know, I third edit. That thing was one edit, B. That thing was just done once, and it was just as perfect as you see it after just one edit.
Now, my next question is two questions, right? I'm an upcoming artist. I've got that idea of spirit, like
send
you said.
Send me a demo, bro.
I've got the same passion. I've got this vision. I can't afford Tebogo, you know? But I want to shoot a music video. How do I go about that? And then secondly, once I've shot the video, how do I get it on a Trace, an MTV base?
Unfortunately, there has to be some sort of investment in the thing, whether financial or by relationship. One of the most important investments you can make is in the relationships you have with people, and you try to bring them closer, or you go closer to them. If you find the people that have the things that you need, and you get yourself closer to them by offering what you have in exchange for what you need, you know. So, and it's my first joint, and I'm an upcoming rapper. Do I really want to spend whatever it is, whatever money I've made on this, on a video that looks like so and so? Or can I sort of invest in a relationship that will get me a video that is very satisfactory and still speaks the story? Then we got to tell the story of the song in ways that we can afford, you know. So you just also kind of have to out the box your thoughts, you know, and because if you're in that thought, then
and I think it's also about, you know, doing the best with what you have, you know, because there's a lot of kids that shoot music videos from their phones, you know.
Yeah, and there's the also that, dope, you know. Even personalities can play a role in that, where if you're the type of business savvy person and you can run a business of sorts, and you're just a leader by thought, and I mean, I don't think you should sign a record label if you think like that, you know. But if you're an artist based kind of person where you're just for the arts, and what a deal's probably great for you, so that whoever is around you will do all the other works, you know. So you kind of have to look at the things that you have and that you can do, you know. I know it sounds great to also want to be an independent artist, you know, but you actually kind of have to know how to run the business for you to be that. I mean, you can't just go, the menu looks good, and you know, so you kind of have to know what you can and can't do, which means you study yourself, you know yourself to a point of knowing all your limitations and all your potential, you know, and then that's how you work, that's how you know what you have, so you can work with it, you know.
All right, so the track is clean, video is clean. Can we talk about now performance? What is the craft behind an actual performance? Is it just as simple as rehearsing and then you go on stage?
Not even. I mean, the audience is a big player in a performance, because this is now your interpretation of these songs that you've made. You can break a song apart and share it in so many different ways when you're performing live. Yes, there's the expression of the artist who gets lost in the music and just gets taken away by the spirit of performing. But I think a lot of that comes from having catered for an audience. What I do generally with my performances is, like, we'll get to a place and kind of suss it out, if it's a booking especially. I'd get there, beg a crowd, you know, go, oh, okay. They like this sort of thing. They're responding to this sort of thing. They're responding to that sort of thing. And again, sort of try and tailor make it for that, because that's what you can do with performances. That's why I think they're so important. You can interpret them in a way that connects people with the song. They may go, oh, damn, I would have never thought I liked that. But because of how you interpreted it on the stage with whatever spirit they were in, then you guys connect in that way. There's a way that the music can speak when you're performing, in which that the person that's in the audience might never have heard or gotten an opportunity to like the joint. You know, you could literally perform the one song in Kandla, and you could perform it in Oranje. It takes a lot of that and understanding those things. You can rehearse all you want, but if you keep giving us the same stuff and repeated stuff, we're pretty much gonna know it. I mean, you look at, for an example, like a guy like AKA, you know, who has a catalog that is really long, you know, and he can do these songs over and over and over and over at every show, just switch them around. But how he does it keeps changing with almost every show, you know, because it keeps growing. And then he finds a new way to manipulate this joint. He finds a new way to manipulate that joint and finds other ways, you know. So you keep also growing. Personally, has become my favorite part of the process. You know, I mean, you make the music, you put it out there, you shoot the videos and whatever. But right now, and for the past couple of years, I've been really in love with the performance factor of things because of what I learned, that you can do so much with it, especially now that I've added like a whole live band situation, you know. So that means literally we can break the song down in the middle of the song, you know. We could start with the last verse, you know, put the last verse third, you know, we can do whatever, which means we're in the spirit. It always almost sounds like a new song when you're in it, so you never get lost in anything except the music, you know?
All right, so let's talk about the most important thing about this, which is money, the ching ching.
Yeah.
How does one go about handling that?
Well, first you try and make it.
Rule number one.
Rule number one, try and make it, you know. Just don't let it be the reason for anything. You need to sort of build a relationship with money where you sort of trust each other. You have to build that money to trust it on the day that is not as bright as yesterday, that it'll take care of you, you know, and vice versa, you know. So just looking at your life and the things you need, separating those things from the things you want, and the things that a lot of people buy things because of the idea of getting them but don't really need them at the time. We all have things we don't need. If we can sort of limit those things that we don't need and get the things that we really use on a daily. I did a show like last week and I hadn't done a show since about February or something, since about Jan. That means I haven't been making any money for the whole year. And the only way I survived was because I don't really buy a lot of stuff, you know. With this attitude or personality trait is really how I survived 2020. So I've never really been motivated by money. I'm not saying I don't love it. I love it. I love the fact that it's there. I love the fact that it can take care of Inosi, you know. I love the fact that it can take care of Impiloyam, you know. But that's all I love it for. The society we live in has made it such an important thing. Uguti, when you survive, you kind of need it. So take care of it so that it takes care of you, because that's the world we live in. But don't let it be the reason you wake up, you know. Let it make you sleep peacefully, yeah. But don't wake up just because of it, yeah. You know?
I like that, man. That's very profound. And speaking about money, you recently got married.
Yeah.
Which is not cheap at all.
Yeah, nah, not at all. I got married with rainy day money, you know. I didn't get a big check. it was rainy day guap. Well, yeah, maybe one day I'll get married, I don't know, huh? So you keep it, and things, because you grow in life generally, and you find things to do or things find you, and having money helps. And the only way to have money is to keep money.
And what about investing? Is that something that you dabble in or are thinking about doing?
I've tried, you know. to tell you the truth, I've tried many times and have failed many times. Almost all the time, because like I say, with my limits and all of that. So I've put in money in things and lost it all, and then I've put in money in things and I needed more money to get out of things, you know. Yeah, I've done many of those things. So now there's what I figured was the best way is to have a person also that kind of deals with that on my behalf, that kind of deals with my money growth and investments and all of that, you know. And you keep people around you that can take care of that. I'm just not that person.
I love the fact that you're mentioning your team. How does one go about choosing, you know, like their managers? How did you go about choosing them?
I'm really into people and like the type of person you are. If you're just a shitty person, I'm never going to work with you. You know, I'm not just going to chase the skill. So how I went about, we had done things before, and there's a certain warmth about it. And that's really what it was. It was really just, I know that this person is dope. And also, I have seen the work, you know, that the work, and also just having met the team around her, she also looks for, I would say, the same qualities, because everybody is sort of, has a certain warm quality about them. I don't want robots around me, because we have to talk, and sometimes I'll go through stuff and I want to share things, you know. The human relationship is very important for me, and how I choose the people I generally work with. You want to have your way with me, be nice to me, you'll probably get that way. Don't give me stuff that I can read on a CV, you know. Just, yeah, the human aspect of things is very important to me.
And what is the importance of having a manager? Because I mean, I'm looking at you, you're a well-established artist. Why even need to get a manager?
I struggle to type up an email. it's cliched, it's whatever. I just want to make music, bro. I think a manager's job is to stress and think about potential problems and potential growth. Like, your mind is just always running, where do we go from here, and this, that, and the third. And I don't want to do that, you know. I don't want to do that. I want to entrust that to someone that I can learn to trust, maybe in time or immediately. But that's an important thing to know as an artist generally, or as a manager, or as a human. Just understand, having an honest conversation with yourself and just saying, what can you do and what can't you do? And I always say this when people ask me, what can you say to the upcoming rapper? I'm like, hey, Baba, speak to yourself. Make sure you're good at it, you know, because if you're not good at it, you're going to be 50 doing the same thing. I've had many of these honest conversations with myself, and I know that I don't have it in me to as much as I'm an established artist, this, that, and the third. I don't want to walk into anybody's office and say, I'm Kwesta, and here's what I can offer you, and here's the analytics of this, and here's the what and of the what. I just want to get there and play the joint, you know, and you know what I mean? That's it, bro.
Now, obviously, everybody's journey is different.
Yeah.
And we all need to make mistakes to grow as people. What's some of the biggest mistakes that you've incurred in your career?
Not paying attention. There's things that I feel like now I should have known, and I don't, because my only focus was just getting out there, and they got it, you know. As much as I know they got it, I need to know from a paper trail point of view, from an everything point of view. It's not as to ignore the back end of the business and go, they're doing their thing, but it's to not engage with it and try and be the guy that does it. But you must know what goes on the whole time. All my relationships in music or with the people I've worked with were kind of this, yeah, go do that, I'll go do that, you know, without even the communication in between, you know. And I've also made many financial mistakes, you know, of putting money into things that are just for keeping up with so-and-so, keeping up with the game, that didn't really speak to where I was going as a human being or as an artist, you know. So I've made a lot of mistakes, bro. And these are the things that make me okay with knowing my limitations and knowing what I can or can't do, and also defining a limitation and just laziness, you know. I've always thought it was not caring about and not looking at the bank statements or the what's and the invoice was, you know, not looking at those things. Kind of, it's just lazy. It's not really just you wanting to just be in studio. It's being lazy. So because all you have to do is know, and that's about it. So that, you know, so that when you question anything or questions arise, all of you have the same answer because all of you know what the hell's going on, like the back of your hand. So the biggest mistake I made was to not make sure that I know everything.
Wow, man.
Yeah.
Couldn't have said it better myself. It's time for a quick ad break. When you come back, we're going to be taking some questions from the audience. We'll be back after these.
AMP Studios brought to you by Old Mutual.
Making a new go these days, go rough. Just ask that guy. So that's why you need Old Mutual Rewards. They're life. See, these guys actually reward you for being anybody can join, and it's free. It's my son's birthday tomorrow, so let's earn some points. Now turn my points into cash, and they send a voucher. Then just shop, show, and scan.
The time is now. Sign up for free to Old Mutual Rewards today.
Hi, I'm Sam.
I'm also Sam.
Meet my little Sam. Only the best for my son.
Sam!
I'm Sam!
This is Sam, live.
I'm Sam.
No two people are the same, so why should their cover be? New personal cover from Old Mutual lets you build the cover that's right for you and your budget. And it's easy to change as your life does too. The time is now to get personal cover that's just for you. Speak to your financial advisor today.
AMP Studios brought to you by Old Mutual.
All right, welcome back to another AMPD Masterclass by Old Mutual. And we're going to be taking some questions from the audience to the legendary Kwesta. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm good.
All right, here we go.
Hola,
Later.
How are you?
Sure.
How do I transition from faking it to making it? Not really faking, né? Because I feel like my brand is built.
Okay.
You know, my quality is good. My voice is good.
Okay. Yeah.
I even met you at the by South by Southwest. I don't know if you remember.
Oh, yeah.
Remember?
Yeah. That's yes. Texas.
Yeah, so I've been trying. I've been pushing.
Wait, you've been trying and pushing by yourself and you got all the way to South by Southwest?
With Imexa, yeah. Okay. I've been doing it independently.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm tired. Like, I'm tired of being independent and not making it, you know. I'm frustrated.
Mm.
I really, really... And... I need a breakthrough.
First of all, I don't want to say don't be hard on yourself. It's needed. You kind of have to be a little bit. But you've done so much already. Just generally doing that all by yourself is not an easy thing. There's a lot of big artists who haven't left the country, you know, about anything. So you've done great in that regard. What I think you kind of have to see is that as much as that is great, I think first you have to connect with the people around you or closer to you. With regards to building your brand and the music that you make, do people around you kind of say that also? Do you think where you play the music, it invokes like a positive sort of response from people, or is it really just you feeling confident about your stuff? You know, I think you have to figure that out and kind of have an honest conversation about that. We think and we want our stuff to be good, but when we play it, it's not quite. And I'm not saying that's what's happening with your stuff, but I think that honest conversation is something you have to do because that's how you determine what else to do, you know? And really, how do you make it from, you said not really faking it, but from like kind of just trying and really doing it, is to keep doing it. I mean, I know you said your journey was long. You keep doing it. And if the one thing doesn't work, you try another thing. And by thing, I mean, sort of maybe play around with different sounds and different genres and try to see maybe what the people are connecting with and not really make that, but try and have you and your identity of music or your style sort of fit in with what maybe a market of sorts that you have chosen or that your music caters for, and try to see if that works. I think as much as it's dope that you're in a masterclass like this, it would be also dope if you also... I think it's important to connect with the spirit of who you are musically. You know, and then I think if all those things are a check, these things that I'm saying, if you think you got them, then it's just a matter of time. You know, I might not be sure because I don't know the whole story of what you might not be doing right. For me to answer your question is to just keep doing it and you just persist. And I know you've probably heard this a million times, but then everybody that said that is right, you know, to tell you that. And I can see your passion in your eyes. It's crazy, you know, and it seems real, but don't let that stop. And improve in the music, because I think if you got all those things, then we have to have a conversation with self about the music itself and go, what is wrong with the music? You know, after going, there's nothing wrong with the push, there's nothing wrong with the hustle, but what's wrong with the music? So question yourself and be honest with the answers, with the things around you. And I think that should sort of give you an idea, and something should give, you know, you should know at least where to go next or what to do next.
I'm the Imperial Thug. Hi guys, I'm Selassie.
What's that? The Imperial?
Imperial Thug.
Imperial Thug.
Yeah. I wanted to ask, it's not like a long question, but it's more artistry.
Yeah.
I remember like, I think it's the 2016 Metro Awards when you won and you like, even skinny guys get recognition.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so like, yeah. I feel like that was dope.
I felt like everyone kept looking past me because I was so skinny. Like,
yeah. Yeah. So, I've gotten into this thing, like, if you're an artist, there's, like, a lot you experience about yourself, you realize about yourself.
Yeah.
And then you, one thing that we know about you is that you have that voice.
Yeah.
You know, that grungy voice that everybody didn't really know about in the past, like, era Boom Shakalaka.
Oh, yeah.
And after that.
I think so, Boom Shakalaka was, like, kind of like the first. It was
Yeah,
starting.
It wasn't really
yeah.
there, but it was.
Yeah.
So, like, the moments of you prepping yourself to, oh, I have actually a good voice and
yeah.
I can like really use it rather than the way I've been using it now.
Yeah.
How did you actually come about to, I don't know, mixing it up and also fusing it with the genre that you were actually going for? Yeah. And after that, what have you learned more about yourself as an artist?
I think it's Yonke Daideng was like a matter, like I find out things about myself all the time and I try not to ignore them. And as soon as I as soon as I just decided to be, you know, I rap how I spoke. I remember even making good. I literally woke up from Maporisa's couch and he was messing around with the beat. And I literally just started mumbling stuff on the mic. There was no words. It was really just... And eventually I turned it into words. But I mean, it's that process of really just saying, I'm just going to be, bro. You know, I'm not going to try and follow these rules or whatever. I just decided to be me and just started rapping. Just happened. I literally said, F it. I'm just going to be, you know. And whatever I learned about myself as an artist is collaborations. You know, in a collaboration, I ask more of myself and I ask myself to do more and I demand more of myself. And I think that's dope because that means I also take a lot from a lot of artists that I collab with, which then in turn means I also kind of grow, you know. So that's one thing I've learned.
Shapfere, Kamalam Uyonge, how do you position yourself in the digital world? Since we know that everything is going digital, okay. And how do you keep your social relevance and that are in line with what you believe is the best things for the brand?
To answer your first one, how do I position myself in the digital world? That's why I have a team, bro. That's why you try and gather a team. I mean, I've been trying to understand so much of social media and from a point of view of where would my space be? Where would I fit in? Because I struggle with a tweet. What I do is kind of pick and choose the stuff I want out there, really. Then as much as I engage with the people that follow me, that's just on conversation level. You know, that's just us connecting and talking, you know. I try not to put on a Kwesta jacket or a Kwesta hat, you know, so I don't have like an alter ego. If I'm socially irrelevant, then there goes the music also, I guess, you know, because it's really one person. I don't put it on and take it off.
My question is, were your parents or the people like that raised you supportive of your career and the music thing? And how did you know that rap was the thing for you? Like,
well, my parents, cool. No, B. Not at all. I mean, and maybe it wasn't all their fault because they didn't have a lot of reference to go, oh, this is how it looks like when it works. That was close enough, at least for them to be comfortable with me doing it, you know. So naturally they're like, ah, yeah, born low, you know. And I kind of had to do drastic things like run away from home and this, that, and the third, you know. And I think what ended up convincing them is just how they saw how relentless I was, you know, and how driven, you know. And they kind of just flipped their approach and just went, let's see what happens when they support. And as soon as they did that, everything just started sort of coming together. But it was a hard fight to convince the parents that this is something I'm seeing because it's something they've never seen before and it's something they can't reference close enough for them to be comfortable. So I don't blame them. I don't have anything against them. I understand, mommy, especially now because I'm a parent. I'm like, oh, I get it. You know, I'm inspired by different people at different times, you know. I don't unfortunately have one person that I go, everything you do, I just wish I could do, you know. Except just maybe I pray for the strength that my mom has, you know. Olin Lam is just someone else with the strength game, you know. But generally, I get inspired by people and places and things, you know. Like the environments, like where I go and the type of lifestyles people have and the type of conversations I have with people are really things that are inspiring. And anybody that sort of has a story of having changed a situation from one of a change for the better in their well-being is an inspiring story. But and there's so many of those. There's not one thing that inspires me except the story of overcoming is the thing that inspires me. And just going to places, as far as creatively going to places and having conversations is really what makes the music for me. Yeah.
But my question is, basically, what I've taken out of this conversation today is the importance of collaboration.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot. You know, you spoke about it, whether it's a relationship with, you know, a student from after that you wait for outside or the type of people that you associate yourself with.
Yeah.
So in terms of you and your collaborations that you've done, how do you interpret your vision of the song to them so that they give you the same content and same energy that you want in that song, especially being a person who also raps in Venec as well?
How we worked that was obviously technology, you know. I didn't really go back and forth and fly into and out of the States, you know. So I kind of showed them and it sent them things and videos and from interviews to music videos that I'd shot and things like that to kind of explain what I represent generally, you know, so there's an understanding of that. And you also kind of have a back and forth or talking about what the songs are about. You try and bring yourself as much as possible to kind of explain it visually. You know, this is where also the visual thing becomes important, because it tells the story where, so they can understand that this is what this is being, this is what is being represented. And as far as where the song is going, and you get it right here, you get it wrong there. It's like I've worked with also just a bunch of other artists from the rest of Africa, and you try and make it as clear as possible, and you're trying to still keep the song as good as possible, you know. But it's like any other thing. I mean, some things are lost in translation, some things are gotten right.
Hi, my name is Dylan in Art DK, and yes, I've only started actively working in music very recently, but I've been writing lyrics for quite a long time. And the biggest problem I come into when I'm writing is how to keep finding inspiration on what to write about, what to write, how to get out of a block, because it's something I run into quite often. And another question I have is, how often will you sacrifice rhyming and wordplay for the meaning?
Yeah.
And how often will you prioritize the rhyme scheme for, I don't know, effect on the beat?
Yeah. To answer your first question, I mean, I think we all hit like a writing block. I kind of literally let it go. I stop and just go, you know, go play soccer, go kick a ball for, or pick up something, or just start a new routine for like a week or 2 weeks or whatever, and then get back into the creative side flowing. And how often will I sacrifice meaning for rhyme schemes? It depends on the song. I rap, you see, and in sort of rap music, there's like a an element of just really showcase. If I'm trying to showcase the skill of rap, you know, the meaning then becomes how dope I am. As I said, that I don't kind of just do the music to prove that I can rap. I kind of just want to say something. Whether I'm talking about us having fun or whatever, I kind of just want to describe a feeling, you know, or capture a feeling. It happens still. I mean, I still rap just to rap, just to kind of, you know, rap and just do it and showcase. But a lot of the things are really just about something, at least. It has been sacrificed. I have sacrificed it quite a bit, actually. you know.
Sambonani. Hello, say, hello, hello. Mr. Taka, feel like anjani, abo.
Yeah.
Le generation le before Nina, like abo Double HP, abo Sleek, abo Pro.
Sure.
I feel like yani grew money, abo. The next generation.
Yeah. Sure.
So my question is to you guys, as the older kids, are you also like grooming the younger kids, or is there a change of times? It's more like do it on yourself and I'll do it on my own. Is there like change? Something like that.
I hear you and I see that a lot. And what you're saying is very right. I've seen it quite a lot. And I do it. I can't speak for everybody else. But, well, maybe I slightly can. I mean, if you think about maybe a Casper, you know, and the work they've done with maybe a Nadia Nakai, you know, or they've put on people and kind of had them around until they can build their own thing and do their own things, you know. But not a lot of us do that. I mean, I've worked with like Umakwa, you know, the TLT, you know what I'm saying? Well, X and I are the same, you know. But, you know, you try and take on what works with regards to energy and what you feel you can offer to a person. So I personally do that a lot, especially through collaborations. You know, I collaborate with people just based on, yo, I think the stuff is dope. And there's different ways in people sort of show love or try and groom, you know. I will do it through TLT no Makwa, you know. And because now it's like the whole game is I can do it in my bedroom. You know, I think a lot of the guys that are now OGs are sort of feel like, oh, okay, then do it. I don't know if that's good for the sport or it really kills the grooming part, you know. But on my bit, I try, you know. I'm not going to groom everybody. And I don't even know if I'd be grooming. All I will know is that I think you're dope and let's give you a shot and let's see what you can do on this platform. And that's really all that can be offered. But I fear a sense of expectations from then the new guy who expect guys to do things for them, you know. That's a dangerous place to be. But also I think that there should be a sense of responsibility from the guys who Sebada Young Tol. So it's like a cash to it. But at the end of the day, it's really a choice, I think. You know, if it happens, it's so great. It's still going to be up to you. Get fun.
Morning, everyone. My name is Tammy, a.k.a. Everybody Loves TQ.
Everybody Loves TQ.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
So I'd like to start by thanking M Studios, MacG, Kwesta honoring us us honoring you. Yeah. Which way is it? The other way?
No, it's you guys. I'm grateful.
For the presence, yeah. For the presence.
Sure.
All right. My question is a personal one. I feel like as an artist, I like... but I'm also a dude from the burbs. My whole life, literally, I've been mixed on both sides of the playing field. You know, I've stayed Ekasi.
Yeah, they're on the other side of
you
the...
You get what I mean, right?
Ring is Zulu, and then Xeni.
What's up, bro?
Yo, what's up, bro?
Yeah, good, man. Yeah. So that's been my situation. And I feel the complications, because even as a person, like, I'm a person that's up to date politically. I'm a person that's... I love to turn up. I'm very complex. So
yeah.
And also when I approached like your Sony's, your Universal, they say I need to stick to an image. But it seems that in the field that you guys are in, on the upper class and the upper, you need to have a certain image. Like when we see you, this is what we see. And for me, that's complex. I don't know how to go about that.
Yeah. Dope, man. That's a question. Dope question. Just, you're blessed, first of all, to be able to do so many things, right? I think you should note that it's not a bad thing, regardless of who says what, you know? As far as picking which one to do and which one to stick to, you kind of pick the message, I think, in your case, because you can do all these things. You kind of have to go, this is what I want to say consistently for so long, so that people can kind of get familiar with something. At least, you know, so they don't get lost in the trail of trying to follow you, because so I think just for sake of consistency, that's why they probably say you need to stick to one thing as regularly, and I think that's what they mean. But you don't have to if you don't want to. Just do you, man. Don't let anyone bullshit you about that. You know, you're a guy that tells stories and sells songs and makes music. You know, how you look is how you want to look. People at the end of the day focus on the music. You know, and what you're saying, especially if they've decided to listen to you. The struggle is getting people to listen. You know, or at least long enough to decide what they think. You know, it's not really for them looking at you long enough to decide whether they like how you look or not. And a lot of people would argue this and say, yeah, it's important. And maybe it is. I don't know. I've never really had one, you know, except maybe just the dreads. But I don't have a certain one way of dressing. I don't think about it. And if you want to, you can. But if they're saying you must, bull.
Okay, my name is John. And I love Vulamagate. Earlier on, you spoke about the fact that you were not making money for the better part of this year. And I think we all know what happened without repeating that dreadful word. You know, this year certainly has been the worst year for many artists. In fact, not only artists, wonke umuntu. If I were to use a local lingo, you know, it's heard about to kadi hairline or kadi washi.
Oh, yeah.
And
what
I want to understand from you is that having seen what actually happened this year, is there anything that you're going to do differently?
I was fortunate enough to kind of be well prepared, at least to be able to still be alive and be able by Sinkwana Nan, you know. But it's difficult to kind of have a foolproof plan of what you're going to do if this ever happens again, seeing as it's something that I find nenyinto, you know. It's not like you can go. But now I think what I took away, at least as a lesson, is that we now know that everything can go to shit, right? We at least know that and have seen it firsthand. So from relationships with money and really our relationships with the market and with the fans, you know, I think and how you plug in and where you plug in, as far as virtual shows go, as far as curating sort of, I don't know, other technological advancements to kind of connect with people and finding those. Everybody has to change their outlook on everything, on their relationships with people, money, and their lifestyles. Figure out creative ways of how to connect with the people and also, very importantly, make an income, you know. The job is to be aware and act upon, you know. So I'm going to do it. I'm going to try it. I'm going to make a lot of mistakes. I'm going to get a lot of things wrong. But the awareness and the action upon knowing that we're in the pits is definitely something I have. And
hello, everyone. My name is Miona. what do you do in a situation where there's somebody big that you want to work with, but this person is a rival, your mentor or your manager or your friend or your acquaintance whatsoever?
Yeah.
What do you do in a situation where you want to work with this person, but you don't want to be in a situation where you have to choose between my emotions or my feelings?
So what do I do if I'm Nadia Nakai and I want to work with AKA?
Yeah, but AKA and Nadia.
And Casper don't get along.
They don't get
you
along.
You are Nadia Nakai.
Exactly. Yeah. What do I do in that situation?
I guess the respectful thing to kind of let it be known that you want to work with this artist. And if there's resistance, go work with the artist. Because I think a dangerous thing would be to not let you do what I'm saying I'm grooming you to do. You know, if I'm saying I don't like MacG, don't go on his show, then I'm limiting you as far as reach and as far as your story being told because of my relationship with MacG. No, man, just do it. If you think it's what you want to do, man, just do it. Just go make the song, bro. But they'll deal with each other. Just go make the song, you know.
Okay, just want to let everybody know I'm Chunes RSA. Chunes. Where do you want to see South Africa in the next 20 years? Like South African music and the style probably and like just the culture.
I don't know what's going to happen in 20 years. I don't know if I'll be playing a role in the music industry in 20 years. But I would like it to be full of people who are about what South Africa will be about in 20 years, you know, who will tell that story. If our story is that of success where maybe there's honest politicians, I don't know. but really, I just want it to represent itself. And I want it to have sold itself to a world, to the rest of the world as a force that is itself, you know. I want it to affect the rest of the world and not be really sort of influenced a lot by the world. I don't want us to copy anymore. You know, I want people to kind of make cheap versions of our shit, and then we say, yeah, that's a cheap version. You know, yeah.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mega Ambition. What are your strategies that you use to keep your brand going to stay relevant in the game? My second question, what are your challenges that you faced when you are an upcoming artist?
Yeah. I don't know, man. I'm just myself. And I think people kind of appreciate that. A lot of people connect with that. And it's also, I think I've found some way to kind of also put this person that I am in the music, you know? And I think that's how the relevance is, because I grow as a person and the music grows as a person, you know, as itself. You know what I mean? If you think about it, you make a song like Ingood because Ngiyashaya, Mangiyashaya, Langhlelkhona, you know, and then you make a song like Ketile Ketile, you know. So it's like a real life thing. As I grow, people kind of grow with me and stuff. And I think that's what they connect with. I don't know. I hope so. Your other question was the challenges I faced. First of all, it was resource. I'm told just to record. It was a nightmare just to get that. I remember when Suga Katlehong, and I used to walk to a Togoza. It's not a long distance, but it's like a good hour and a bit walk, you know, to where I was going. Just to record, you know, because around me I'm not focused on except that. And then as soon as you kind of got it done, got that part done, and you recorded something, it started becoming platforms, you know, to perform, you know, to sell the music, to talk about your music, you know, interviews and stuff like that. But those things are overcome by just persistence and like I said, you must do to that other guy, you know, and just keep being persistent and just going there and doing those things. You know, I remember I was one of those cats that just used to be there YFM, you know, the entire time. It's apparently trying to get a good 16 in, you know, before even thingy season scoop. There was a rap activity jam, you know, but I was that guy. So that's how much I'd fight also for the platforms. You know, I went to the radio stations and camped outside, got a couple chances to rap, and as soon as I got that chance, got another chance, you know, and eventually won a competition, won the first week, won the next week, won the month, you know, going there to try and coming back about 20 times having failed, and then maybe the 21st time again, go back in again for the next 10. So just persistence. But it's platforms. Platforms were a big challenge, you know. It's easy. I don't want to say it's easier now. Now you can just do it and plug it in online and just sort of get people going into trying watching it. But we had to kind of go to the radio stations because we couldn't really upload stuff on YouTube, you know. And even if we could, technologically, we just didn't know how to.
Awesome. Guys, thank you so much for the questions. Hopefully you learned a lot, and hopefully next time you'll be sitting on this very same couch.
If you leave here with anything, just leave here with get everything, I'm going to do what I'm doing, you know, and just persistence, love, and all those things. And good luck with all that, man.
Music has changed. How it makes us feel never will. The time is now to visit mstudios.co.za.